I'm Jeff Bradshaw, Redneck Restorations. This old truck brought to you by ElderlyIron.com.
Something is amiss.
Well, over a year ago, say this himself, I bought these off of eBay. They're made out of billet aluminum. They'll go in there just nicely. Like that. So, the guy wants $200 and some for them. Or make offer. So I made the offer and he accepted, but when I got him, the machining on him is not really nice. And once you put them on there, you can see the poor machining. They didn't get polished out all the way. So I contacted the buyer and he said, "You got them, didn't you?" When you see these on eBay, it's kind of a blurry picture. There's a reason for that. So don't be surprised with what you get if you get these. I've had my say. All right. That's going to go in there. But, firstly, we want to take this one apart, see how it's put together, see what we got to do. Now, you might have thought you'd never give them $200 for those aluminum billet, the fancy hot rod stuff. Well, the problem is, if you can find these pieces of the original factory, they're not in any reproduction, you might pay $200 a piece for them, and they're very difficult to find. So this one I see has a screw in here, cracked out place where there used to be a screw. What does our billet have? That's got the places for the screws. But how's this mounted? Why, it's just clipped in there. There are no screws fastening this thing in whatsoever. I think what I will do, I'm going to pull this out of here and clean up the metal, get some bare metal contact going, and then put some Never Seize on it. I gotta remember how I just did that. Okay, clean it up. Well now, sorting through the parts pile, here's the left side. These are riveted in place. So that means install these. It appears as though you just put them up against there and push them in. Getting them out is a whole other story. You can't just push them in. Doesn't work that way. I like the idea of screws better. Let's experiment. Are you ever going to put that on there? Hook it in the top, pushing it at the bottom. Not this one. Not working. It's a better experiment with the better one first. This is different. Oh, look how that's done. You see the design of this. Go that way, and it goes that way, so when you push it in against that, go behind and stay in place,
whereas this side is the opposite. This one, top is essentially the same, but the bottom is the opposite of the way this one is bent. It appears this one has been subjected to mangulation of the angulation. Again I say, we better find out what's going on and how to do this before we go any further. Drilling. Well, the record button bandit struck again. What you did not get to see was me drill out the rivets and pull the plastic off the front of this. So now I'm going to go to the other side and compare. Well, not compare. I'm comparing here. This is going the opposite direction of this one. I believe this to be correct. It's not near as extreme. This could probably use a little tweaking. I would have to rebend all of this to match this if I want to rivet this together. But if I use sheet metal screws and drill out the bezels, then I can mount this in place, it'll be secure, and I can screw everything together that way. However, see, it hooks in from behind this way, though not very well. You slide the bottom in until that don't work. Don't work at all. You're relying on, no wonder they all broke. You're relying on the face of this to be pulling in that direction against this, pulling in that direction to pinch it. And you're putting all that stress on that piece of plastic. So, crazy, man. I gotta get this out of here. Well, I did this once, but I didn't hit record, so I have to do it again. I was in Fastenal. They had a whole bunch of this stuff on clearance. Cheap. Those are such beautiful things, because these are the perfect trim screws for the 50s and 60s cars. Just right for a guy like me. Not only is it just right for that. Okay. That's the smelly doctor right there. In case you're wondering, that's just what the doctor ordered. Now for a little destruction. Pull in one side. Ta-da! Bring the two sides together. Push. And try to turn. Not getting anywhere. There we go. A whole lot of cleaning to go on. I think I wore out my Dremel brush for that already. That's where it's going to do all its grounding. It's a goofy design, but I do not have an engineering degree. So who am I to say? I do have my little cut brush. Springs will rust out in these sockets, and then you don't get any more contact. Such as we might have the case here. Just go buy a new one, you goof. We're not going to use these ends anyway. Don't forget to put that back on. And this has to go get cocked diagonally before it'll come out of there. There is no indication of any springs ever being in there. Messed up, man. Well, you know how everybody has a can full of pens and none of them work, but we keep them anyway. And this is kind of why. But I went to my drawer and I opened up, took out some pens, and every one of them worked! Except this one. Apple Family Dental, you lose. Snipping. If I use that end, that limits the amount of compression I can do, but let's see what happens. Makes me want to tear apart a good socket. Have to consider the compressed length. If you make it too long and you can't compress it far enough, then you can't put the bulb far enough into the socket. And the other factor to consider is whether or not that spring is going to slide off to the side and make contact with the ground or with the other lead. So the bottom contact of the bulb, let's get a bulb, shall we? I would use amber bulbs, but I don't have any. These amber bulbs are cool. The distance from that pin to the contacts is nearly the same as what's down there. Okay, so there's a little shelf down there that won't allow this to go down any farther. But is that just from rust? The tabulated one. Why? It's one single large spring. We might be able to save that. Aha! It's free! It's free! Of course, not getting this tabulated one down in here is going to be a little more difficult. So I have to push the spring down far enough to hook it. And while holding the spring in the compressed position, to get the tabulations to line up. Like it. And we have
springs. Spring. We got the spring happening. Like it. Made in USA. And we put it in something to dry. Well, apparently the record button band struck again, so there was a lot of stuff that you didn't get to see over there. This one has a bit more to go. Rubber does not want to supplicate. The heat gun does not want to operate. It is still recording, isn't it? Not much time left. Ooh. That didn't take much. Probably won't last long either. Ah, it's in there. With the park lamps engaged, let us see. You gotta remember, don't connect them out here. Let's see, this one went like this. Now that it's lubricated, that clipping function is the only thing that holds this thing in. I believe some modification is in order here. It's just such a bad design. Got it the first time. Woo-hoo. I just hope these are clean enough to take the solder.
allow it to congeal. If you ever remember when I talked about a lifted ground, this is a good way to show you an example of it. You ground it to the ground, the light lights. It goes through the small filament for the park lights. However, if you have a lifted ground, it'll ground back through the park light bulb. So here's the park light bulb lead, and what you end up doing is going through both filaments. The park light doesn't light up because there's not enough voltage there because it dropped going through the first filament. But if you ground it, you see the brightness increase. Kind of hard to tell in the sun. But anyway, there's your electrical lesson for the day. Let's do the next wire. Don't twist them up much. It lets the solder flow in between the strands. Okay, so it's weak tension. I see why they bent that one, because it makes more sense than doing it the way this was. But they engineered it this way. Cat's eye 85. The angles work whichever way you do it. I want to expand that. I actually thought it was going to be stronger than that. See, my thought is bend those back far enough to roll these tabs over. Let's go for it. Now tack weld it, it'll stay. Problem. I mean, it's as though you should be able to just push it up against there and slide it back and snap, snap, and it stays. But it did not do it on that side. Well, let's see if we can fatigue the metal out to where it's completely useless. Yeah, I have no originals to go by. And I don't know anybody that does. And the guys that built these on the assembly line are all dead. Okay, so there may be one still living. Theoretically, it should just be able to go like this. And it stays. That didn't happen. All right, so obviously it doesn't work. However, it does give me an idea. What I'm looking at is this plane here, and they were curved back that way. Once I straighten that out, well, now this is too far that way. So I got to keep this flat while bringing this out. Oh, whoever knew it would be like this? Whoever knew? I can't get enough depth out of it. I think I should like to put the other two screws in. And what that's doing is... Ah! Got it upside down. Duh! Why am I getting this wrong? I Now it has come off of, these are like a rivet in here. I drilled out these two rivets that I didn't have to. Those are going to have to go back in. I might have to put another one here. So for the screws for the lens, these are brass inserts that are peened over on the back side, and it holds these two pieces of metal sandwiched together, except for the rivets here, which I drilled out. Boy, it just gets more complicated and more complicated. So I've got to close this gap. It's right tight against the gasket. Won't get it any tighter than that. The only way to do it is to bend this down, because this edge is going to go against that edge. Like that. So I guess if I gasketed this edge somehow, if I had some grommet, if I had some of that little black grommet, but then I've got some little vacuum line. I put my rivets in there and it really sturdied this thing up. I need to think longer. So if I put this on here and try to bend it like that, all you've got is the thickness of this right here, and that's where this edge and this edge need to come together. But then of course these would prevent that. The only thing I can think of is to put something on this edge so that the screws would be pulling that against it. Let's talk more doom. Well, I went out back after some really thin washer hose, windshield washer. Didn't find any thin stuff. Got some of this. And I saw the conduit and I thought, you know, I wonder what that will do. Because it might just roll off. If you stick it on there like that, and you push that up against there, it will just roll off like that. There's plenty more where this came from. You do realize if this works, I'm leaving it that way. Make sure I've got it the correct direction. Oh, they're giggling about what they're gonna do. Watch what he does when we do this. Wunderbar! Okay, I'm gonna do the other side too. Yeah, you can see him hanging out there. But that's okay. Alright, this needs clean. Yep. Now these do have a top and bottom. Bottom what got the grooves and no little place to let the water out.
Sound like it.
Yes.
That does it for this episode. What will I be doing on the next one? I have no idea. But until then, for Redneck Restorations, this old truck, I'm Jeff Bradshaw.
Where'd you go?
Get the lubricant out of here and do another scrubbing.
Have one on you, huh? Why, miniature bulbs. They make miniature bulbs and car bulbs.
I don't want to say these are new old stock, but there ain't no barcode on that box. That almost rhymed. So,
did I hit record already? I did.
Why? Jumped right out of my hand. Probably be easier without the light bulb in the way.
Get.